translated last week, I started to speak about the gifts of the Spirit, and I believe that, you know, these particular things are coming to the church in this very hour for a purpose, for you and I to be able to be utilized effectively in the kingdom of God, actually, and the light in the sense that many of us have already come to the understanding of these particular things, but for other people, we've not experienced what it is that God is able to do. And in this particular church, we believe in the fullness of the move of the Spirit. For those of you who are here, actually, if we have any guests, I truly welcome you to our service, and I'm delighted that you decided to take the time to come and to share these moments with us. But simply to state that we want to begin to move as a church, but not only as a simple church, but a powerful church. We see that God had empowered His church to be able to go against the works of the enemy. The battles that we fight on a day-to-day basis are not physical battles, but they're spiritual battles. And for those particular spiritual battles to be won over, we need, it is necessary for us to possess the gifts of the Spirit, which are the weapons of our warfare. When you're equipped with the gifts of the Spirit, then you're equipped with supernatural abilities to be able to take you into a winning position against the enemy. Amen? Amen. And so I don't want you to be unaware about what is going on in the spirit realm, but I want you to be fully learned in those particular things. And so last week I stated to you that there are three different categories of spiritual gifts that we deal with when we look at the book of 1 Corinthians that we read last time, the nine different gifts of the Spirit, which the Bible speaks about. And we broke them down into three different categories. The first category was revelation gifts. The second category that I spoke about was power gifts. And the third category was inspirational gifts. And we stated and we defined those particular gifts in this particular simple manner, is that the revelation gifts are endowment and empowerment from God to allow for us to be able to have insight of the truth of God. In other words, whenever God is beginning to operate in the mind of God, which is omnipotent, omniscient, and omnipresent, when God begins to operate in that particular dimension, God actually opens up the spirit realm for us to be able to share in that particular understanding of who He is. These are revelation gifts. Things that come according to the knowledge, the intelligence, the capacity, and the truths of God. And then we spoke about, and we briefly defined the power gifts, which consist of the gift of faith, the gift of healing, and the gift of working of miracles, which we'll speak about today. And those particular gifts are actually the anointing of God coming on man in order for them to fulfill supernatural things. And last but not least, we spoke about the inspiration gifts, which are the prophetic, the word of the prophetic. We have the speaking in tongues and the interpretation of tongues, which we'll see on next week so that we can really define them and fully understand them. But those particular ones are given for the proper use of or for the edifying of the church. Amen? And so those inspiration gifts allow for us to be able to operate in the midst of the church effectively and have the ability to move. And so now, last week we spoke about the word of wisdom, not simply being intelligence given to you or wisdom given to man, but simply being able to know what is the mind of God and the truth of God. And we spoke about the word of wisdom being able to have an insight of the future things to happen. So whenever a prophet is operating in the prophetic office, and we'll speak about the prophetic next week, so stay tuned for that. But whenever a prophet is speaking in the prophetic office about things that are to come in the future, they're operating in the gift of the word of knowledge. So being able to know the future, speak of the future. And then we went into the gift of the word of knowledge. So that the first one was the word of wisdom, rather. And then we spoke about the word of knowledge, which actually speaks to us about the things that are and the things that were. When I'm operating in the gift of the word of knowledge, I'm operating in the things that had already happened or the things that are happening. In other words, whenever somebody comes to you and tell you that I perceive that your mother, who is in Africa, whose name is Anne, that I've never met, is going through a particular situation or has gone through a particular situation, I'm operating in the gift of the word of knowledge. Amen? Knowledge speaks about what is and what was. Wisdom speaks about what is to come. Amen? Alright, so we spoke about those things, and so I'm not going to belabor that so that we have enough time to expound on the rest of them. And so today I want to be able to speak to you about the discerning of spirit, which is the third gift of the in the category of revelation gift. Revelation gifts, once again, speak about the truth of God. The discerning of spirit, as I stated last week, it has nothing to do with the realm of the mind. Being able to discern spirit has nothing to do with the mindset. Rather, it has to do, or the discerning of things or mindset, it has to do with the discerning of spirits that influence man. This is why I call them the spirits of man. So the discerning of spirit, or the gift of the discerning of spirit, allows for you to begin to have an insight as to what kind of spirit is operating and driving and influencing an individual. When somebody is influenced in one way or another, or is acting in one way or another, in order for us to have a full comprehension of what it is that is driving and leading them and inspiring them to do that, we must have the gift of the discerning of spirit so that we may understand the human spirit that is being driven behind them. And so there are three different areas in which this particular gift can operate in. We can operate in the discerning of the spirit in the divine and the demonic, as well as the human or the natural level. Okay, and so what I mean by that is that when we go into the divine, we begin to have understanding of things that are not necessarily seen with the physical eye. And we begin to understand things that go beyond the understanding of man as far as what is operating within an individual on a day-to-day basis. When we speak about the demonic, as I stated also last week, when you have the gift of the discerning of the spirit, this is not the spirit that allows for you to begin to pick out demons left and right. But because of the discerning of the spirit, you have the ability to know what the behavior of an individual is, which gives you a glimpse of what is actually driving behind them. And so the discerning of the spirit allows for you to know either the good or the bad spirits operating behind men. Amen? Do you know the difference there? See, we're not trying for us to begin to say, well, some people have a special ability to begin to pick out demons from individuals, or to notice, and you will see, for example, someone who's operating in a ministry of deliverance, for example, they're able to have the discernment of spirit, of the spirit, so that they can know what is going on in men, whether good or bad. It's not that they have a stronger ability to recognize demons, rather, they have a strong ability to recognize spirits, period. Amen. Amen. So if you can note a good spirit within an individual, then you can notice a bad spirit within an individual. Have you ever met somebody, for example, and when you meet them, all of a sudden your spirits connect? Has anybody ever told you, I love your spirit, I love how you resonate, right? The world says, I like your energy, or I like your aura, whatever you bring, and that is a part of the discerning of the spirit. And individuals oftentimes will operate in this particular dimension without even noticing it. Now, I've shared in this particular church before that many even of our children operate in this particular gift without actually having the understanding of that gift. Why? Because you know that your child will be approached by somebody who does not necessarily have a good intention towards them. And you begin to notice that your child has a reluctance for them to be able to associate. What is happening there is that God has given unto man innately a particular level of discernment of spirits of man. Are you with me? If a child can do it, then you can do it. The issue, and here's the thing about the difference between children and adults, is that with children, it is very evident to them because they have nothing in the back of their mind hindering their perception of what is going on. But as we grow and we begin to develop all of these particular habits and these particular experiences, what begins to happen is that we begin to associate experiences with certain personalities. Right? If he's saying this, he must mean this. If she came to me and said this, she must want something. Hallelujah. Has somebody ever given you a compliment and all of a sudden you're like, what do you want? Amen. What do you want? You know, husbands and wives, darling, what do you want? What do you need from me? And the reality is that that's not me operating and discerning of spirit, right? And or whenever, for example, a woman will come and believe that she has the gift of discerning of spirit because now you've been in an argument with your husband and you had a disagreement and all of a sudden you say, well, you know what, you possessed. Because the way you're acting right now, it must mean you know there is something wrong. Anybody ever went through that? You have a spirit, you have a bad spirit. No, it's not that you have a bad spirit. It's just that I'm associating your behavior to something. Something that I may not fully understand, but I know is there. Hallelujah. Don't call your wife a witch because you got into an argument. Don't call your husband possessed because you're disagreeing on a point that you would have done your way. Hallelujah. Rather, I want to have the discerning of spirit so that I can discern the divine, the demonic, and the human or the natural. Again, it is not primarily concerned with discerning what devil is operating here. Rather, it is the discerning of the kind of spirits a person possesses. So, excuse me. The discerning of spirit is the divine ability to see the presence, and I want to define this in this particular way, the presence and activity of a spirit that motivates. What is motivating you? If you keep that in mind and you say, God, I desire for you to fill me with the gift of the discerning of spirit, he is giving you a spirit that allows for you to know what motivates individual in both the good or the bad. So when somebody comes to you and say, I love your heart, I love your spirit, they're operating under that particular gift. And it's necessary for us to possess that and to walk efficiently in it, especially in the church of the living God. Hallelujah. Why? Because the discerning of spirit will also give you an indication whenever somebody is standing over here at the pulpit, and because we love the move of the Spirit, and we love the demonstration of the power, that you begin to discern who is coming with a good spirit or a bad spirit. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm not interested in saying amen and I love you to every man of God that holds a microphone to impress me with a good word. Just about every other person has the ability to put together a good sermon. Charisma has nothing to do necessarily with being spiritual. I can be very charismatic and have nothing to do with the Spirit of God. Obama is charismatic. Hallelujah. I would say that the majority of presidents in the United States, majority of people that won't work in government positions are very charismatic. Why? Because they have a particular sense of conveying and convincing individuals the way that they're thinking so that you may begin to think the way that you think. Why are you Democratic and why are you Republican? Why are you supporting Trump or are you supporting Hillary? Amen? Because there is a charismatic sense in them that allows for people to follow. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So in the church of the living God, I want you to begin to walk in here. As you walk in here, have the desire to know what is motivating the Spirit. I've told you before, it is not because I am gifted in the Spirit that all, or rather, it is not because sin exists in somebody's life that the gifts of the Spirit automatically leave. I can operate in the gift while my life is not necessarily free. Hallelujah. Amen.
Hallelujah.
See, here's the issue, and here's why most of the time we're emotionally driven by what we see, hear, and experience. Is that we embrace what strikes the eye to the point where we do not see what is driving behind what's behind the eye. So that we are accepting when we don't know what's behind you, yet we reject you the moment we find the true you. Hallelujah. How can you love me today when you didn't know that I got drunk yesterday, and when I laid hands on you, you still fell? But the second you come to know that I still struggle with my drinking, all of a sudden my anointing is gone. It's not that the anointing is gone. It's just that your faith has been removed from being able to believe in the thing that drives the man. Now, what we need is the discerning of spirit so that we can begin to operate and that we can begin to know what is going on behind the man that is delivering the word, that is delivering the gift. Amen. Amen. The Bible says that Christ is coming back to take a church that is spotless, that is pure. In order for us to have a church that is pure, we need a discerning of spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. The issue is, and the question is, do we want the gift of the discerning of spirits? Do we really want it? Or do we want to still stay and hide behind our secret identities? And the church said,
Amen.
Hallelujah. There's a lot of people, a lot of us, that operate as secret agents. There's a lot of James Bond in the church. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
We see what you portray, but there is somebody else in the back. Hallelujah.
Amen.
This is why we allow ourselves to go and do things behind the veil and still present ourselves as saints on a Sunday to Sunday basis. Right? Right? Somebody say, preach, preacher. This is good stuff, right? And so, this is where we need to begin to have the discerning of spirit so that we can begin to prepare the church that will be wrinkleless and spotless for the taking of our Christ whenever the time comes. So, the inside of the discerning of the spirit gives unto us also the discernment of the similitudes of God, the Christ, the Holy Spirit, cherubims and seraphims. And so whenever you hear somebody, for example, saying that I was praying, or in the middle of the service you'll hear me say, I see angels, right? Or I hear, or I see the movement of the spirit, or somebody experiencing the visible manifestation of the Christ in front of them, right? Because Christ or God is spirit. It is under the operation of the gift of the discernment of spirits. Once again, it works with the good and the bad. Everybody with me?
Yeah.
Yes? All right. I don't see many of you guys writing down. This is important stuff to write, right? So, as we speak about these particular three gifts, so we spoke about the gift of the word of wisdom, the word of knowledge, and then discerning of spirit. These are revelation gifts. They are revealed. They are revealed by God. They are enlightened by God. It's like God lights up your mind, and now you have clarity on what the things to come are, the things that are, the things that were, as well as the spirits that are operating around us. They are revealed. Spirit are not shown, they are revealed. Amen? Alright, so now, as we go from revelation gifts, we enter into power gift. This is the gift that all of my African people love to operate in and to experience. Power gifts are those particular gifts that begin to bring the manifestation of miracles and the moves of God in the midst of the body of Christ. Okay, power gifts include the gift of faith, the gifts of healing and the gifts of miracle, the gift of miracle. We'll start by talking about the gift of faith. So there are many levels of faith. It is not necessarily the same simple faith that we're talking about whenever you come, to receive salvation. If you go to the book of Romans, chapter 12, verse 3. Romans, chapter 12, verse 3. I want you to see kind of the difference here. Book of Romans, chapter 12, verse 3. The Bible says to us, "For I say, through the grace given to me, to everyone who is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, as God, listen to this, as God has dealt to each one a measure of faith." As God has dealt to each one a measure of faith. God has given to every single one of us a certain level of faith, a certain dimension of faith. There is a grain of faith within every single individual, whether we want to or whether we understand it or not. So it is different from the gift of faith that we receive, right? The measure of faith that is given to every man is at a certain level. But when we're speaking about the gift of faith, we're speaking about the endowment, once again, or the empowerment of the Holy Spirit being able to give you something that is greater or something that goes beyond what you already have. And so here we speak of three different realms of faith. There's three different realms of faith. There is natural faith, which every single man has. Whether you are a Christian, whether you're a believer or an unbeliever, we all possess natural faith. What is natural faith? The natural faith is the level of faith that every single person wakes up with and walks around with that allows for them to say that, listen, I'm going to get in my car and I'm going to Irving, and in the back of my mind, I have confidence that I will get there. The same faith that somebody going fishing, for example, will say that I'm going to go fish with the faith and the hope that I'm going to catch fish when I get there. Every single individual possesses a level of natural faith. Whenever somebody says I'm going to plant in my garden or tomatoes in my garden, and I will water it, even though I do not see the tomatoes yet, I only see the grain, but faith allows me to believe by continuing in a particular process that I will come to see the manifestation of what I invested. That's natural faith. Hallelujah. I don't need to be a Christian to believe in that way. I don't need to be in church to believe it. Every single person has that level of faith. And then we have come to what we call saving faith. What saving faith allowed for us to come to believe in God. Saving faith is the kind of faith that when we hear the gospel and we are convicted at the heart, we begin to believe in a God that we do not necessarily see. Amen. That's saving faith. So natural faith, everybody believes in it. Saving faith allows for us to believe in God. So that we can have a relationship with Him, even though we've not come into a physical manifestation or a physical encounter with Him. And then the third dimension, of course, is the gift of faith, which we are speaking about. The gift of faith is particularly special in the sense that it awakens the supernatural ability in man that would not be humanly possible anyway. The gift of faith allows for you to operate in the impossible realm. It allows for you to bring manifestation of what humanly is not possible. That I can begin to do things beyond my five senses, beyond my ability to hear, to smell, to touch, to taste, and to feel. I can begin to operate in faith to begin, as the Bible says, to move mountains around me. Things that are inexplainable by science, by technology. This is the dimension of the gift of faith that begins to be manifested. It has nothing to do with the doings of man, but as we defined it last week, the gift of faith has everything to do with God manifesting himself and saying to you, I want you to rest and let me take over this particular moment. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The gift of faith makes it to where God comes down from heaven himself and performs the supernatural, and because God is intervening in the fullness of the gift of faith, what begins to happen is amongst all of the gifts, hear me out very clearly, amongst all of the gifts, the only gift that is unlimited is the gift of faith. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The only gift that has no limitation is the gift of faith. And the reason why the only gift that has no limitation is the gift of faith is because God himself intervenes on his own behalf. He does not go through the vessel that that we are as men in order for him to perform the miracle. And he comes out himself and performs the work himself. He does not need the intervention of man. He does not need for anybody to do that. This, the gift of faith allows for individuals to be able to speak out things, and then God comes and begins to work according to the word that man spoke, and it is oftentimes inspired by God. So the manifestation of the divine through the gift of faith allows for God to orchestrate every single thing on his own. So when Jesus is speaking to the storm, okay, there is a storm, they're all in the boat, and the boat is shaking, right? Naturally speaking, they would have to wait for the storm to be over for them to find the calmness. But Jesus opens up his mouth, and God himself intervenes and stops the storm. That's the gift of faith. The gift of faith made it to where when Joshua is in the battlefield fighting against his enemies, he says that he declares for the sun to stop in order for them to finish the battle, and the sun stopped in its track. That's the gift of faith. Because these are things that men cannot do on their own. They're supernatural things that can only be manifested by the intervention of God himself. There is no limitation when it comes to the gift of faith. The gift of faith does not need you to lay hands for it to come to manifestation, because once again, God comes down and performs the miracle himself. These are the types of miracle that nobody can begin to claim that I had something to do with it, because God has everything to do with it from start to finish. Those particular moments whenever you're broke and your rent is due at the end of the month and you don't even know where the money is going to come from, and all of a sudden somebody knocks on your door and says, I don't know what it is, but something impressed in my spirit to cut you this check, and the check is exactly the money that you needed, because somewhere in there you prayed for God to intervene on your behalf and you believed, and God himself came and knocked on that particular stranger's door and said, comforter. A comforter is somebody that goes up against an enemy on the same level, on the same dimension, with the same level of strength, and you defeat your enemy, you defeat your foe. That's a conqueror. I've conquered my enemy. But when you're operating in a gift of faith, when your enemy comes, you don't even have to fight. All you say is fall, and the enemy falls. The enemy is defeated. The gift of faith allows for God to intervene on man's behalf without any effort being exerted out of man. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen.
We need faith to begin to move mountains. We need faith to begin to expand in areas of impossibility. When you begin to look at somebody that has no legs and I declare grow, and all of a sudden the legs begin to grow. That's faith.
Yes.
Because it is only God who can perform such miracles.
Yes.
Is anybody hearing?
Yes.
Only God can perform such miracles. When it comes to the realm of impossibility, I want to begin to ask God, give me
gift me with faith. I want to believe where no man believes. I want to be able to see you and performing things that I cannot perform on my own. Whenever it's a woman that's been taken where she cannot bear any children because there's issues on the inside of her, and you begin to pray by faith, and God begins to grow organs that were not there. That is faith in action, because only God can operate such miracles. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I've seen miracles of faith with my own eyes where people are praying for individuals. You see all these, I was watching on YouTube a man of God who was praying for people who were dealing with obesity, that were literally overweight. And he called them out and said, if anybody wants to lose weight, come down. And as he began to pray, the skirts began to fall because the weight began to reduce right there and then. Are you with me? Are you with me? Our God deals in the realm of impossibilities. Hallelujah. God, I don't understand how come I'm missing hair. I want you to perform a miracle where my grandfather and my daddy and the generation before them were having hair fall out, but I want you to change the generations after me from this day on, even if you have no hair. Hallelujah. God can do it. You laugh, but God can. You laugh, but God can. See, people who move in faith believe in things that nobody else would believe them for. This is why the woman with an issue of blood didn't care about what people were on her left, people were on her right. She said that if I can only touch, I know that something can happen. Listen, she didn't have to do anything. Listen, here's how Jesus said it. He looks at his disciple as a woman with an issue of blood touches him. He looks and he says to his disciples, I feel a virtue has come out of me. The gift of faith. I allow for you to open up your mouth and begin to draw God to do things beyond even his expectation. The gift of faith allows to trigger the manifestation of God. God can be seated on his throne, but because of faith, there is nothing that moves God like faith. It is impossible to be pleasing to God without faith. When I operate in faith, then everything around me begins to be God-like. And this is why I say there is no limitation when it comes to faith. Because when we come to faith, we're talking about God himself manifesting. And if there is anything that limits God, then he is not God anymore. But when God comes to manifest, everything that was impossible becomes possible. Everything that you could not do begins to be doable. Everything that you could not see. That's why things that you haven't seen manifested in your life, believe in faith and you will see it come to pass. If the world says it's impossible, let God have the last word. Let God have the last intervention. Let God do the last move in your life. Faith. Faith moves in ways that no other can move. We see the manifestation of the gift of faith in the Old Testament with Moses. Whenever he's in front of Pharaoh, and Pharaoh has his magicians there, and the Bible says that they threw their staffs on the floor and they turned into snake. But then there was a bigger snake, a brazen snake, that God allowed from Moses' hand. Hallelujah. It was not the doing of Moses, it was the doing of God. Moses raised his hands in front of the Red Sea, because the people were looking at a situation that was dire. When you're in front of a situation that is impossible, in front of you there is a Red Sea, behind you there is Pharaoh and his army,
and I don't know whether to go left or right because my life seems to be over. But the Bible says that when Moses raised his hands at the gift of faith that was in him, the Red Sea opened up. And the Bible declares that they were able to walk on dry ground. Now, here, listen. The Bible doesn't say that they were walking on mud, because you would naturally think, because water was present, that they would be walking on mud, but they were walking on dry ground. In the midst of water, can you imagine you being in a position where everything says no and everything is pushing against you, but God intervenes on your behalf, and not only does He gift you, but He changes the whole nature of what surrounds you. Hallelujah. Not only can God heal you, He can give you supernatural strength. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm able to begin to do things that I didn't even have to work for. Elijah was sitting in a cave running from Jezebel in the midst of the wilderness. Didn't have to work for his food. The Bible declares that he was hiding in a cave, but God was feeding him with crows. Only God can do that. A hot, warm meal, breakfast, lunch, dinner, served, cooked by God himself. Hallelujah. He's got spices the world cannot make. Hallelujah. He's got tomatoes in the soup that you never tasted. See, the type of soup, you've tasted those soup that they just make you go, and you want more and more, because only God can do things that God can do. It comes to faith. Faith begins to move things around us. Like Daniel finds himself in the lion's den. How can you explain someone who's in the midst of a place where people who preceded him didn't come out, but he sat there and he went to sleep because the Lion of Judah intervened himself. See, there's I'm not just talking about people in the Bible. You know, we will speak of man of faith when you read the book of God's General. You read about individuals like Smith Wigglesworth. You guys heard of him?
Yes.
Man had such great faith. That he was a simple individual, a plumber by trade. A plumber by trade. As a matter of fact, a lot of people think of him as a great big preacher. But his wife actually used to preach for him on missions that they started. Are you with me? But his faith was the kind of faith that believed in God in all circumstances. The story says that one day Smith Wigglesworth, he comes back from work. And as he gets home, they tell him by his neighbors that his wife had passed away in a room in their house. For 2 hours, she had been dead. And as he gets there, he drops everything at the hearing of his name, and he walks in and he says, no, she's not dead. He walks into the room where the wife was laying dead, and he picks her up and he says, live. Are you with me? He says, live. And she comes back to life. 2 hours dead. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Will your husband pray for you when you die of him? Oh my goodness. Will your wife pray for you if you die too early? Do I believe that I can bring back the dead? I need the faith that moves. Let's talk about the gifts of healing, the gifts of healing. I spoke to you last time that there can be many, many gifts of healing. This is the only gift in the Bible that we see up in plural form. It doesn't speak about the gift, but it speaks about the gifts of healing. Meaning there's different forms of healing, different types of healing. And I will say to you, even though there is a multiplicity of gifts of healing, this is the only one gift that is obviously and very apparently is limited
And the reason, and we'll speak about the reason why here in a minute, but I want you to understand that there can be as many gifts of healing as there are diseases or infirmities. The kinds of diseases call forth a certain level of gifts of healing. So there are different kinds of manifestation of healing. When it comes to the gift of healing, you will see that because of its multiplicity, the Bible says to us, by the stripes of Jesus, the many stripes, we are healed. Correct? When we begin to look even in the Bible in the way that Jesus healed, well, you'll find that only Christ Jesus was the one who possessed and operated in the fullness of all nine gifts of the Spirit efficiently. Whenever it comes to human beings, we are limited in our operation of the gifts of healing in particular. And the gifts of healing allows for us to heal all kinds of, or man, the different manners of diseases. When you read in Matthew chapter 17, this is one of the verses that oftentimes we speak about when we talk about spiritual warfare and when we talk about deliverance. The book of Matthew chapter 17 speaks about a young boy who was a lunatic, and he used to throw himself in fire and he used to throw himself in water. The Bible says that the disciples of Jesus were told about this young man, and they went and prayed for him, and they could not heal him of his disease. And then Jesus comes, and he says to the disciple, "O ye men of little faith, how long will I be with you? For this kind only comes out but by fasting and praying." Meaning that the gift of healing that they needed for that particular boy necessitated for them to go through fasting and praying. Mm-hmm. Are you with me?
Yes.
Different dimensions of healing require different dimensions or different manifestations and tactics of individuals. Some people are gifted with a certain level of healing in one arena, and other people are gifted in healings in different arenas. But to each and every man, God has given the ability to be able to operate in them. And one of the reasons, once again, as I said it before, that God could not allow for this particular gift of healing to be full in every man is because when you begin to operate in the fullness of the gifts, then we begin to be God-like. And anybody that reaches a dimension to be God-like always has a tendency to want to overcome God or go over God. Hallelujah. Therefore, God limits in certain areas for our own good. Hallelujah. This is why sometimes you will pray for individuals in one arena and you see them heal, and then you go to a next arena and you cannot heal. Hallelujah. Do you know that Peggy Hinn doesn't heal everybody that's in the stadium? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He has a lane by which God allows him to be anointed for his gifts.
Yes. Yes.
When we begin to be God-like, we begin to search to jump over God, to be God. There is too many examples in life of individuals that God anointed so much with the gift of miracles and healing that did not handle it properly. When you read in the history, in the history book of Christianity, you see individuals, and we study even in theology, the Stephen Jeffries, the Jack Coles of the world, the William Branham of the world, and I think that's probably the most familiar name. You know William Branham, right? Panamis Branham. William Branham was actually an individual that God used so powerfully in the 1960s that he had a dimension of revelation that so many men didn't even have, could not even come close to him. The way that God would perform miracles with him was so tremendous that people began to see him as a God. And as they began to see him as a God, this is where it began to influence him to develop his own doctrine. to develop his own way. This is where we have the brandness movement of today. Are you with me? Right? And so, because of that, he developed his own doctrine, he developed his own way, and then in the 1960s, he received this particular revelation, and you can read about this, the revelation that whenever, you know, you read in the book of Revelation, chapter 11, it speaks about the witnesses that are in front of God's throne, right, in God's presence. He received the revelation that he was one of them, right? And this is why many people in that particular movement begin to worship him. And they began to, even when he died in the 60s, he committed an accident head on against a truck. He died. Many of his followers believed that he would resurrect on the day of on Easter morning because of the way that he began to portray himself. Every individual that God begins to use to a particular dimension of healing and tremendous miracles, he always has to withdraw a little bit so that he can keep you grounded. This is why I always say, when you pray, always pray, God, don't give me something that I'm not ready to handle. Don't give me with gifts that will stray me away from you. I want to walk according to your power, according to your miracle that you've instilled in me, but I don't want to have anything that will destroy my relationship with you. And so the multiplicity of healings according to the different types of diseases. Let me give you three keys and we'll stop and I'll pray for you. Do you want to learn how to be healed? Or how to heal? Let me give you three secrets about healing. Do you know the best way to heal? Is to pray for yourself. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
There is more records of people praying for themselves and receiving healing than other people praying for you and receiving. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The reason for that is because of what I just explained. When you pray for yourself and you heal yourself, there is nobody that gets the glory but God.
Yes.
Are you with me?
Yes.
If I'm the only one healing the sick, then you begin to be dependent on my presence to see the manifestation thereof. This is why God allows for you to heal yourself better than any healer out there. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Don't always be thirsty. It's funny. And we see the manifestation of these things oftentimes in crusades, but it just goes over our head. Every single crusade, every crusade of healing that I've been through, whether Benny Hinn, whether Morris Sorello, whether all those men of God that healed, R.W. Shambaugh, you go to his meetings, people would get healed before they would get laid hands on. Are you with me?
Yes.
Before they even got into the arena. So by the end, all you see is Pastor Benny. This man came in on crutches. And all of a sudden he felt the power of God. No. It happened way before Benny Hinn came to know.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. The best way to receive healing is pray for yourself.
Yes.
Pray for yourself.
Amen.
The second way, hear me out, is have a family member pray for you. I don't have time to go into this. If you came to Wednesday Bible study, you would understand this. But there we get into the arena of familiar spirits. There is authorization that family have that people outside of your family do not have, according to the scriptures. So it is easier for you to pray for your brother, your sister, your mother to be healed and for them to receive that healing. Why? Because you are walking in alignment with their lineage. Therefore, you hold a particular unction or an anointing on you and an authority to speak into your lineage before somebody else has the access to get into your lineage. Are you with me?
Amen.
The last way is, as the Bible says to us in the book of James, chapter 5, verse 4. You read where the Bible says to us, if there be any sick among you, then call the elders, call the ministers, so that they may lay hands on the sick, that the sick may be healed. And then, whenever you cannot get healing on yourself, whenever you cannot get healing from your family, then come to the church and we'll pray for you. Don't always run left and right to try to get something that you can receive yourself. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Have you prayed for yourself? Have you prayed for your healing? Have you earnestly asked God, well, Pastor, I prayed, but sometimes you got to be diligent in your prayer. What God is looking for is not just that 3-minute prayer. I told you there's different levels of healings. There are some sicknesses and diseases that need for you to pray for 5 minutes and you get the healing. There's other diseases that need an hour prayer. There's diseases that need for you to fast for a week. There's other diseases that need for you to be steadfast and faithful 6 months. And then God heals you. Healing sometimes is a process. It is a regeneration. When I go to the hospital and I pray for the sick, some people get up from their bed, and some people, I know that I have to take time and time for them to be able to receive the fullness of healing. I don't mind it as long as they get healed.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Let us be diligent. Diligent in our asking for God's gift to be manifested. When you receive that gift of healing, you can begin to operate and practice on yourself. Do it on you, and God will do the rest. Send it. Send it. I want to pray. I want to pray with you.